The Pleiadian Mission, A Time of Awareness. Part 7. Life in the Pleiades. Billy likes to talk about what he has learned from the Pleiadians. His contacts were mostly all with Semjase, the Pleiadian woman of whom he obviously has fond memories. I could even feel a little sadness in him when he spoke about her. It was obvious that he greatly missed her. I remember one night in particular we were standing outside under the clear, beautiful Swiss sky, and he was pointing out into the stars to show me where the Pleiades were. I was asking him about the planet Erra, where the Pleiadians had come from, and if he ever had the chance to go there. According to the information I had learned so far, he had not visited the Pleiades or seen their civilization. But I was wrong. He had traveled there in 1984 with Quetzal, the Pleiadian base commander on Earth, and spent 3 days learning about this advanced culture. Quetzal had frequently come by to see Billy after his normal contacts had stopped with Semjase. They had become good friends, and Quetzal had invited Billy to return to the home planet of Erra with him. Quetzal needed to return there for some reason, and Billy was welcome to go with him. Visiting the Pleiades. Even though Quetzal had been stationed on Earth for many years, his home was still in the Pleiades. Whenever he had the chance, he would return for a few days to once again be among the level of consciousness that is more comfortable for him. Here he could relax and let the concerns of his command vanish for a while and enjoy the serenity of his home world. As he and Billy approached Erra, Quetzal explained how their society had developed into a peaceful world of unity and harmony. Billy was well aware that the Pleiadians had not always lived like this, but had won their peace through thousands of years of war and struggle, a lesson that he hoped would be understood on Earth. As the speeding beamship broke into the Pleiadian atmosphere, Billy was surprised to see that the terrain looked so much like Earth. Not only is Erra mostly water, but the mountains and forest reminded him of his own home in Switzerland. There were no large cities with towering buildings as on Earth, but instead the small population of Erra was spread out into smaller communities that span the planet. Even within these local communities, people lived in more rural settings and kept a distance from each other. It was like they were living with nature, tucked away in little settlements that were almost undetectable from the ground. As they flew over several small populated areas that looked like cities, Quetzal explained that almost all of the manufacturing and production of products for living was done on other planets in their solar system so as to not upset the ecology on Erra. They had long since developed a balance with nature that was well protected. Nowhere on Erra was there a smokestack or pollution of any kind. The atmosphere was perfectly clean and healthy. This helped contribute to their good health and to their long lifespan of over 700 years. The beamship touched down on a landing area at Quetzal's home. The ship's drive systems were shut down, and Billy and Quetzal stepped out into a beautiful, clear, and sunny day. One deep breath of the high oxygen content was all Billy needed to be reminded of how poor the air on Earth had become. Quetzal had informed him that on Earth the oxygen content was dropping to very dangerous proportions, which would lead to disease and the damage of nature. Here on Erra, Billy's lungs gasped as he felt the surge of pleasure from the clean air. Just the idea that the Pleiadians were being so careful with their world was very encouraging. The main house was white in color and resembled a dome structure lot unlike some future-looking homes on Earth. Quetzal showed Billy around and explained some of the technology that was built into the home that monitored the air, communications, food supply, sleep, health, and many other aspects of living. Organic intelligence, much like that of the beamships, was also present here and was built into the house, helping to create a high standard of living. Located just a few hundred yards from the main house was another similar-looking home that housed another of Quetzal's families. He had two marriages and two families of children. Here on Erra this was very common as you can certainly love more than one person, and in a society that has all but eliminated emotional problems such as jealousy, most Pleiadians entered into more than one marriage. In Quetzal's case, his marriages were quite successful and were providing him with many hours of pleasure with his wives and children. Many Pleiadians have gardens, but don't actually work in them. The task of maintaining the gardens and food supply was normally carried out by machines. Quetzal was proud to show Billy that he was working his own garden with a set of hand tools that Billy had provided him with from Earth. It was quite an odd thing for Quetzal to be out working in his own garden without machines. He even had garden gloves, seeds, and shovels from earth, which had attracted quite a bit of attention from his neighbors, for they had never seen this before. The idea of working with the soil and getting your hands all dirty was quite a novelty and was catching on with Quetzal's friends. Beyond the garden was another interesting-looking building that had special interest to Quetzal. He had taken advantage of his travels to many worlds and started a collection of different kinds of vehicles. There were many cars, bikes, and trucks from Earth, as well as many other travel vehicles that were very unusual and strange to Billy. Quetzal had over 100 strange contraptions in his little museum and took great pride in understanding all of them. He often worked on them and kept them all in good running condition. The Pleiadians have long understood the power of thought and the spiritual bonding that connects all living beings together through creation. Because of this, they are very protective of the consciousness of thought that is created by all who live there. Over thousands of years of development, their thought processes are tuned into one another at very high levels. If visitors to Erra project negative thoughts, they will be asked to leave the planet so as to not disturb the wonderful balance of thought energy that everyone enjoys. The ability to project thoughts to another place on the planet is very common and is the socially accepted method of visiting. Telepathy, the ability to communicate by thought, is practiced by most of the population. Devices such as phones are non-existent. Try for a moment to envision what life would be like if everyone on the planet were contributing part of their thought energy to a common pool that was used to protect the health and well-being of the planet, the animal kingdom, the food, and the health of all inhabitants. There would be no greed, hate, anger, or negative thinking, but only true understanding and love among everyone. Even though most communication is mental, there is still a tube type of system to travel around the planet. You can travel to almost anywhere on the planet in a very short time. This tube system is mostly above ground and available to everyone. When you are riding on the tube, there is no sensation of movement because the problems of gravity and energy have long been overcome by Pleiadian science. The tube cars are something like our monorail systems on Earth, but are far more advanced and intelligent. As with other structures on Erra, the tubes can think and carry on a conversation with you about your destination, and answer any questions you may have about the scenery or topography of the planet. Billy was only able to stay on Erra for 3 days with Quetzal and found it very hard to return to Earth. Life in the Pleiades was such a joy to the spirit that just the thought of returning to the low consciousness of Earth was not very appealing. Quetzal had made it even harder by suggesting to Billy that he could move here with his family, if he liked, and leave the cares of Earth behind. This was a hard decision, indeed, for life on Erra was very stimulating and creative. All the way home Billy was thinking about it, but knew he would have to stay on Earth to fulfill the mission that he had put so much energy into. The trip back to Earth took around 7 hours, giving Quetzal a chance to educate Billy on many other facts about his planet and its people. There were many similarities about Earth and Erra that were not accidental. After all, Earth had been originally colonized by the Pleiadian ancestors who had brought with them plants, animals, and foods from their own worlds. Over the past several thousand years Earth had become much like Erra in many ways. The Pleiades. The Pleiades are a small cluster of stars located in the constellation of Taurus, the Bull. During the winter months you can look to the northern hemisphere, and if you look closely, you can see 6 little stars in a small cluster that are sometimes mistakenly called the Little Dipper. There are actually 7 stars in the Pleiades cluster, but usually only 6 are seen by the naked eye. Depending on the time of night that you look at them, this little cluster may look like a small saucepan with a handle on the left side. If this is your position, then you can move your eyes to the star in the top right position. It is named Tegida and is the area where visitors from the Pleiades come from. If we were able to fly towards Tegida and continue on by it for several more light years, there would be a group of 254 blue suns. Here our ancestors live in a solar system much like our own. Much has been written about the Pleiades throughout our history. They are sometimes called the Seven Sisters, or the Daughters of Zeus. In the Bible they are mentioned frequently as the Seven Stars. The Kiowa Indians have a folk tale that says 7 Indian maidens were being chased by bears. The Great Spirit came to protect the maidens by raising a giant tower to block the bear's path. The bears fought to reach the escaping maidens and left the powerful claw marks that are seen today on the Devil's Tower in Wyoming. The young maidens were then placed into the sky and became the seven stars of the Pleiades by the Great Spirit, who protected them. The Pleiades also show up in ancient Egypt, for those who study the geometry of the Great Pyramid, Cheops, on the Giza Plateau. Many unusual mathematical coincidences present themselves. For instance, the rotation of our solar system around the Pleiades is 25,827.5 years. If you take two base diagonals of Cheops, which are 12,913.75 pyramidal inches, and multiply them by 2, you get exactly 25,827.5. Is there a connection? Tegeta. Merope. In 1771, an astronomer named Charles Messier was the first to chart the sparkling Pleiades. From atop a hotel in Paris, he charted 45 stars in the system. The Pleiades later became designated as M45 on the star chart. Several other observations and mappings have been made since, and now it is believed that there are more than 2,300 single stars in the Pleiades. Erra, the home planet of the Pleiadians, is located in the system around Tegeta approximately 500 light-years from Earth. It is just 10% smaller than Earth and is rotating in a system with 8 other planets. They now occupy 4 of the planets with cities and manufacturing. Only 400 million humans live on Erra. They have concluded that this is the ideal population for their world for several reasons. Their understanding of how the universe was created and how it is evolving along with the creational spirit has led them to regard planets as part of creation that are also evolving, and they treat them with respect just as they do animals, trees, and all other forms of life in the universe. Population control has come about in a desire to keep their society spread out and sharing the resources of the planet equally. There is also the consideration that they like to live in connection with the spiritual energy produced by nature. This seems to require keeping the population at a certain level so as to not overpower its energy or draw too much from it. This is a rather refreshing attitude, since here on Earth the resources of our planet are considered to just be for the taking, and most people give the planet no consideration at all, and if they do, it's just thought of as some giant mud ball that we live on, and we can do whatever we want with it. Many years ago when the Pleiadians first traveled to Earth, it was because of the similarities of the two planets. Not only is our atmosphere similar, but nature is much the same on both planets as far as oceans, mountains, etc. Over the years the similarities are even closer since samples of plants, minerals, and animals have been taken to the Pleiades and developed there. It is for this reason that the Pleiadians have found the Earth very comfortable to visit. Language. The Pleiadian language is not so dissimilar to our own as far as the sound and phrases. For instance, in their language an hour is called an aju, a day is called a musal, and a month is called an asar. It seems that the forefathers of the Pleiadians who visited Earth influenced our civilization many times in our past, and they have left behind the influence of their language, which has worked its way into some of the languages we have on Earth. For instance, citizens of Erra may pass each other and offer a simple greeting to one another by saying, Salom, a word which means peace and wisdom. In Hebrew we find the word Shalom, which means peace, and is normally used as a greeting or farewell. This word was influenced by distant relatives of the Pleiadians over 9,000 years ago. Erra, the home planet. The planet Erra has a green atmosphere, which they control. It contributes to their health and stress-less way of life. They sleep only for hours a day because they have advanced methods of psychic control that induce a deep sleep quickly. Most of the food is still grown in the ground and is affected by their collective thoughts that control the digestive system, so they don't have to eat as much, and the food seems to last them longer. They explain that on many occasions they have brought foods, plants, and animals from Earth and other worlds, which gives them a rich selection and variety to choose from. They have a very high technical understanding of how food affects their thinking processes. They are primarily vegetarians, but sometimes indulge in small amounts of meat when they feel they are becoming a little too dreamy or lightheaded. They have discovered that meat gives you grounding in your thinking, so they have engineered a small animal which looks something like a rabbit and that supplies their meat. They normally would not eat another living creature, so this one was chosen because of its slow evolution. On a visit to Erra, we would find it to be about the same size as our own planet Earth, with a passing of day and night, temperature, and climate all very comfortable to us. As Billy experienced, even the air would be healthy for us. The oxygen content of the air is 32.4%, with traces of argon and other gases at 3%, and nitrides around 67.3%. Surface gravity is equal to 1.0003, just slightly higher than Earth, and the density is 5.521, while the inclination of the axis is 22.99 degrees. The diameter of the planet at the equator is 12,749 kilometers as the planet travels at 11.19 kilometers per second through space. They have a rotation of 365 and one quarter days, compared with our 365-day year. A day on Erra is 23 hours and 59.4 seconds, which is almost the same as ours here on Earth. They have 13 months, with compensation every 23 years. Living in a parallel world. When the ancestors of the Pleiadians, those ancient Lyran warriors led by Asael, were traveling through space looking for a home, an error was made, and their fleet slipped a part second out of normal time and landed in a Pleiades that is not on the same time pulse as Earth. Because of this, if we were to fly to the Pleiades that we see in the night sky, we would not find any life there, but instead an uninhabitable planet with a very young, blue sun. The Pleiadians live part of a second out of the time frame that we are in. When they come to Earth, they have to make a slight adjustment in their instruments to compensate for the difference in time in order for their ships to be seen, or else we could not perceive them at all. The Pleiadians are far older than we are in reference to the number of lifetimes they have led, and they now live a more spiritual life. This means they are experiencing and learning more with their spiritual senses than with their material senses. This use of spiritual abilities could be, in part, how they have contributed to their long lifespan of more than 700 years. They are human, just like us, with few physical differences. Their skin is whiter than ours as a result of higher evolution. It is a natural function of evolution that the body material becomes less dense, with less pigmentation through multiple lifetimes, and the Pleiadians are several million years older than we are as spirit forms. When they first settled on the worlds that they now live on, they were 7 to 9 meters tall, 21-27 feet. Their body size changed quickly within a few lifetimes because of the planet they live on, and they now are about the same size that we are. Their average age is now between 700-1,000 years, mostly due to the control of spiritual energies gained through numerous lifetimes. They have no medical problems as we have, for they control health through psychic balance. They feel that here on Earth all of our medical problems are caused by illogical thinking. As we create thoughts, we are forming bolts of energy which have an effect on the cells in our body. These thought energies can be measured in polarities, such as positive or negative charges of electricity. If we continue with illogical thinking, we are creating charges of energy that depolarize the cells and have an effect on the performance of the individual cells, which leads to illness. It has long been known in some societies on Earth that our thoughts play an important part in our health and can contribute to a longer life, especially in the Eastern cultures where meditation is practiced as a means of controlling their thinking. Here in our Western culture, we don't try to prevent illness through control of our thoughts, but instead, wait until the illness is obvious, and then we treat it with chemicals and drugs which are designed not to treat the source but to override the symptoms. That's why we have so few cures and recoveries from illness. The Pleiadians say they are not superhuman with the great powers that we may think they possess. They are men and women, like us, who benefit from the knowledge of many lifetimes. They are not teachers or missionaries and do not come on behalf of any god to give us the long-awaited peace, as creation does not confer any obligation on them. They understand our right of free will to evolve on our own, and they remind us that peace will come only when the people of Earth take responsibility for their own future and learn to create their own reality. Relying on or believing that someone else or some other power is going to bring peace will not make it happen. They feel an obligation to other life forms to help, but not to interfere. The Pleiadians are not superhuman with great powers. They are human beings just as we are and must constantly strive for perfection. Born in the Pleiades. Pleiadian men and women marry and have children just like we do. Probably the major difference in being born in the Pleiades is that their understanding of the reason for a birth is different from ours, due to their spiritual development being so much more advanced. Here on Earth we are at a loss to prove the validity of reincarnation, but in the Pleiades it has become an exact science, allowing them to understand who is being born and what the purpose is of the coming life. You see, many of the more spiritually advanced leaders on Erra had the ability to make a spiritual connection of some kind with the incoming person, and read who they have been in the past life and what their purpose is or coming into this new life. A mother, for instance, will make a point of trying to find out what name the incoming person wants to call themselves, since they feel a person's name is an expression of not only their spiritual development, but has meaning relating to the path of education that they are on. They think of the incoming spirit form as a person who has lived other lifetimes and is beginning a new one for a specific reason. Because of this, they are reminded that this incoming spirit form has led many lives before and is now coming out of a sleep-like state to start another life. The idea of age means nothing when you consider that all of us have been young, middle-aged, and old many times before. To think that you are better, smarter, or somehow more advanced than someone younger than you is incorrect. When a woman becomes pregnant, she opens a window of opportunity so that a spirit form may come back into the material life. The decision as to which woman the spirit form will come into is not entirely up to the spirit form, although there is a tendency for a spirit form to stay within the same family, if possible, which opens up the possibility that your great-grandfather may become the son of your grandchildren. Creation itself has something to do with the mechanism of parent selection. This process is not completely understood by the Pleiadians. They have advanced to a point of spiritual understanding and cognition that allows them to procreate or cause people to be born at a certain time, such as they did with the old spirit form from Lysen, but they seldom do that. They are also able to contact a spirit form when it is on the other side, if they want to, but do not recommend it, saying it is uncomfortable for the spirit form and is not very interesting anyway. The spirit form does not know any more than it did when it was in material life, and usually does not want to be bothered. Once a woman becomes pregnant, within 3 weeks the incoming spirit form will decide whether or not to inhabit the new body that is being created. Abortion is allowed only during this time. This is the level of understanding and morality on a Pleiadian world. The mother and father both contribute some of their genes in forming the body for the incoming person. Later, as the brain is forming, the incoming spirit form will send impulses to signify how many brain connectors to create, so the wisdom the spirit form is carrying from the many accumulated lifetimes can be handled by the brain once it is formed. Once the brain is developed, the spirit form then transfers a copy of all of its wisdom into the acids of the brain where it will reside. During the following months of pregnancy, the mother will attempt to make spiritual contact with the incoming person to become better acquainted, so she will have a better understanding of how to help out this person with their new life. The Pleiadians are able to understand, for instance, the path of learning that the individual is on. They can look into the previous lifetime and see if there are emotional instabilities of any kind that need to be dealt with, or if there were events during that life that left trauma or mental illness that should be addressed. They can tell if the spirit form is happy and well-balanced, or plagued with hostilities and anger and what may have caused it. During the pregnancy, the mother will be able to learn much about the person coming in so that she may have a clearer understanding of how to assist them in their new life. Since Pleiadian women are not possessive of the incoming person and do not consider them a creation of their own, it's more like a partnership with another spirit form. There is a more open attitude taken towards raising the child and sharing its development with others in the community, especially with other members of the family. This would seem very peculiar on Earth, since we think of our children as our own creations to mold in our image. How often have you seen a proud parent boast that his son will become a great football player, doctor, or work in the family business? And isn't it common for us to guide our children to an image that we hold of them? If we stop for an instant and view our children as people on a path of discovery and learning of their own, we might start to find some explanations for behavior that we are not able to understand and personality traits that don't make sense to us. If we recognize that these are people who lived lives before and have brought forward wisdom from previous lives, we can begin to understand why we all have different aptitudes and different levels of intelligence and knowledge. We are all on our own paths of discovery and learning, and need different information at different times in order to continue growing. We do not learn the same lessons in life at the same time, so we must learn to give each other space to seek out answers to questions that are needed for our continued spiritual growth. Life is like a school where we are all in different grades and different classes. Once the individual is born, they have the capacity to understand their past lives and their chosen lessons in the new life. Since the Pleiadians do not treat children as their own property, they give love and attention to all children and help each other with their educations. Newly born people are helped emotionally and mentally by shielding them from the negative influences until they can learn to think and understand themselves well enough to cope. The first 10 years of their lives are spent in education, which helps them gain complete understanding of whom they are and the path of growth that they are on. In other words, they are helped to understand the meaning and purpose of their life before they have to go out and deal with it. Only positive influences and environments are provided during these years, so they can become completely secure and well-balanced within themselves, and then they are exposed to the more negative forces when they are better able to deal with them. Here on Earth there is not yet an understanding of how to communicate well enough with an incoming spirit form to learn about their previous life, so we can't understand how to help them. We are simply born and thrown into a hostile world and forced to manufacture defensive emotions and behavior patterns to survive. Our lives on Earth are mostly hard and difficult, since we have no idea why we are here or what we are supposed to be doing, not to mention living in a civilization that is controlled by men of power who seek control over others, instead of living in a world based on love and wisdom. After the first 10 years of self-discovery, the next 70 years of life in the Pleiades are spent in education, maybe up to 20 professions are learned. Once they leave their educational years, they work 4 hours a day and spend another 4 hours pursuing the proper balance of creativity and spiritual growth. Since Pleiadians believe the purpose of the material life is to gather information through the physical senses and then feed the spirit the wisdom learned from experience, the emphasis is put on personal growth and achievement, based on what is good for the individual. The basic philosophy is understanding the importance of personal spiritual growth by taking 100% responsibility for themselves and not relying on a god, myth, idol, or any other outside influence to solve their problems or take care of their own learning. Instead, the ability to communicate with higher consciousness is taught, so the individual can come in contact with the creational spirit which guides all beings in the universe. Only through understanding and cognition of the laws of creation can one hope to evolve to higher forms of consciousness. This is the end of Part 7. For more information about the Pleiadian mission, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Again, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Also subscribe and share this video. Let the whole world know the truth. Thank you for listening. Remember that knowledge is power. Please, don't be left in the dark. Please continue to Part 8 in the next video.